anonymous 24-hour disposal for Cambridge residents. Drop boxes are located inside the first floor lobby at 125 6th Street. More information is available at cambridgepolice.org/dropbox. Thank you.
Did you know that children under age 6 should be tested at least once a year for lead? Did you know that if the results are 5 or more, the child should be retested? Lead is found in paint, dirt, and dust, especially around older homes. Lead can hurt the way children learn and grow. The only way to know if your child has too much lead is a simple blood test. Lead poisoning is preventable, and we can help. Please call Lead Safe Kids, 617-665-3863.
World Music has been bringing some of the finest international and contemporary dance and music artists to Boston and Cambridge for over 23 years. We are a nonprofit member-supported organization. Please visit us at www.worldmusic.org. Call us at 617-876-4275 and mention you saw us on CCTV and get a 10% discount to our next season. Thank you. We bring you the world.
Hello, welcome to All Is Well with Dr. John Lukiams. I am very excited that you are watching me right now. I am a motivational speaker. I love to inspire people, to encourage people so that their lives can be taken to another level by making the right decisions. So my friend, won't you tune in every Monday at 7:30 p.m. and every Tuesday at 12 noon to 2 p.m. You will not be the same. Therefore, why don't you contact us at cfmfan.org or 206-777-5885. God bless you.
This is Cambridge Inside Out. I'm Susanna Sagat.
And I'm Robert Winters.
And we're here today.
We are here today.
Thank you so much for joining us. Yeah. We have a great show. A half an hour and another half an hour. A great hour of fine entertainment.
And we may even have guests today.
We might have a guest. And Robert has done some numbers magic. And I'm so excited to hear about this.
That's right. I'm like a little child in a candy store.
And you're the first to know this.
That's right. Yesterday, I received the official 2013 Cambridge election ballot data and got to play games and stay up until 2 in the morning last night just goofing around and learning fascinating things. Absolutely fascinating stuff. So I think until our guest arrives, perhaps I should just sort of do a little bit of update about where we stand on one of the topics. So, late breaking news. As you may recall from when last we met, there was a possibility of a recount in the Cambridge City Council.
There was.
It's a stunning reality.
Huh. You know, what happened to that?
Well, let's see. You know, we went from margin victory from 15 down to 6, up to 13. And right now, that's where it stands. So there was a petition for a recount from Minka van Bizekum, who had finished 10th, just out of the money by 13 votes over behind Dennis Carlone. And so the petition for the recount was filed. They met last week at the Election Commission, and they approved the petition for the recount.
Fishing vote?
Well, you know, it's unfortunate. The way you petition for a recount, it's like a form, and you can either check machine recount or hand recount.
And
it was a little unclear because I think what Minka wanted to do was sort of a hybrid where they verify everything by hand, but then they create ballot data and then they just run it by machine. But it wasn't an option on the form. So as it stands right now, we're going to go through the old-fashioned recount.
Oh, boy.
So, yeah, hand recount. Very exciting.
When does it start?
Well, now here's late-breaking news. Ugh. Wait, we need sound effects, like a ticker tape machine or something. So I just got the word that, in fact, the recount, should it proceed, is scheduled to take place beginning next Monday after Thanksgiving.
Okay.
December 2nd. Nobody knows for sure how long it would take, but it won't be super fast. But if they're really efficient, they might be able to do it within a week. But they actually had to set aside a lot more time just in case. So they set it up so it should run from Monday, December 2nd through Saturday the 7th.
Where? Sorry. I'm so excited about
Child,
this. I can't.
You cut me to the quick. It's a line from The Wizard of Oz, by the way. And then they pick up again because you cannot do this stuff on the Lord's Day.
You cannot canvass or electioneer.
On the Lord's Day. That's what it says in chapter 54a. There shall be no canvass on the Lord's Day. So they have to take off Sunday and pick it up on Monday. And again, these all begin at 8:30 in the morning till like evening. And they can't do it on the Tuesday because, well, people are busy because, well, you know why. On December 10th. There's an election that day.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
So they need to have the
workers go to the polls. December 10th. You have to go vote. Very important election.
That's right.
It's the final for the Congressional of Massachusetts 5th Congressional District to replace Ed Markey. And there's, I think, four people on the ballot.
Okay.
So go vote. Go find out who those four people are.
Definitely do that. So they have to take that day off because a lot of the people who would be working on the recount are the same kind of people who might be wardens and clerks at the polls. So, all right, so they suspend things for that Tuesday.
And thanks for reminding us.
Yeah, and then they pick up the very next day and they continue, and they could go as late as Saturday, December 14th. So they've actually allotted 2 weeks to do this, or really 11 days if you want to be specific about it. The location, there was many a rumor about this occurring up at the Concord Avenue Armory, but breaking news, that ain't happening. It's scheduled to happen at the Willis Moore Youth Center at 12 Gilmore Street in exciting Riverside neighborhood of Cambridge.
Wow, why?
Yeah. Well, because it was available.
And it was available.
You know, it was real tricky. You know, some people said, well, why don't you just do this in the senior center? But, you know, there are people who need to do things in the senior center. And, you know, taking it away for 2 weeks, you know.
It's a small space.
Yeah, yeah. So they can't do that. So
Because they're going to need 25 tables, right? A table for each candidate?
You know, at least initially, but the way it would really have. It's actually kind of interesting going to the meeting to learn some of the details in that what. And there's actually another meeting that began 8 minutes ago at Sullivan Chambers.
You can't go to that.
I can't go to that.
You stay here.
Stuck here. So. But anyway, they have to look at every ballot to make sure they're at least okay. If there's a ballot that's clearly going to be a number one for people such as David Marr, Mark McGovern, Dennis Bainsand, et cetera, those ballots are never going to move because they go with the number one choice. There's not enough to elect them. They will eventually be elected, so they will never be transferred. Voters could have drawn cartoons and screwed around, you know, all day long to the back end and made overvotes. That wouldn't make any difference because the ballot ain't going to move. So there's no reason to get all worked up about it, so you can have some great efficiencies in doing the recount. So they'll just set those aside, stick them in an envelope, going, that's going with David Marr or Mark McGovern or whatever, forget about it. The only ballots they have to be really careful about in terms of checking for voter intent are the ones that have the potential to transfer. And specifically to transfer to candidates who will ultimately be in that deciding 16th count where there was these really, really narrow margins between the candidates. So there are some efficiencies to make this go quickly. And I think I know that we're doing some meetings earlier today with some experts who were advising some other efficiencies. So I'm hopeful that it won't take nearly as long as people say, but they do have to at least allow for that amount of additional time. So as we say, that commences the next coming Monday, all right?
Yes, I have breaking news, too.
Wait, we have breaking news.
We have a guest.
We do have a guest.
So, see, if you don't call in, you have to at least come in. So we have a special guest here,
Oh.
She's coming. It is.
I have to put lipstick on.
No lipstick. Nothing.
Need, no need.
We have
Marjorie, aren't you supposed to have like the sergeant? aren't you supposed to be escorted in by the sergeant at arms?
I'm supposed to be like home, like still cleaning and cooking.
And I just came from that, state by representative the way. Marjorie Decker.
Hi.
We're so glad you're here.
It's only
so
for
much,
you guys.
And we appreciate
it. Today was my day of cleaning.
You were dressed so much more colorfully than the rest of us.
Oh, that's good, because trust me,
it's
been a day of cleaning.
We're so glad you're here.
God. So happy to be here. Hi.
Oh, hey. So you did
What's
hear,
going on?
Well, there's a recount happening in Cambridge.
No.
Yes.
Seriously? How's that going to work?
No. It's going to be busy and tedious. And it's supposed to start this coming Monday.
I heard.
Yeah.
It's got to get done.
It's got to get done.
People need to be able to predict what's going on and
absolutely,
who to turn to.
Absolutely. I mean, I was able to do a little bit of analysis.
But you're psyched about this. Tell the truth.
No,
we're
actually.
All psyched about
I'm going to tell you, I'm psyched about elections and ballot data and doing all the analysis and whatever. Personally, I could kind of do without the recount. Because it just drags it on, honestly.
Yeah,
I need
get like
rest.
2 weeks of blogs out of this.
Oh, you think I can't just generate more? I believe it.
The problem with our viewers is that we get 2 more weeks of the show
yeah,
on this,
that's
too.
Right.
No,
that's
I think
right.
This is great. You guys know I was watching you on election night.
We know. We got.
I was texting
this
you,
this
watching you.
This shows how great social media is. Alice Wolf was there with us, our former state representative, and she said, I wonder what's happening in the election in New York for the mayor's race. And
we
so
had,
we were on
we
the air, so we couldn't tell. And we had our correspondent texted us, and we were able to report breaking news on the air right there. We broke news probably
right.
faster than the regular channels.
Marjorie's just one of thousands we have out in the field every day
thousands.
Working hard.
Can I get a contract now that'll be off the council?
There we go.
I need the raise now.
So, hey, well, I should actually ask you, what was that like, actually just sitting one out
yeah.
and watching it on TV as opposed to being kind of, you know,
so I was in
up.
My pajamas, I was home drinking tea.
Oh, that sounds nice.
It was not, and you know, I didn't go down on purpose. I felt like I wanted
yeah.
to give everybody their space and their moment, whatever it turned out to be.
Yeah.
But of
yeah.
course I was watching it. It's my city, you know, I'm a citizen too. So it was, people have said, oh, this must have been so hard for you. And it's not been hard. It's actually been really nice. But I think if I were leaving the council and leaving public service,
yeah.
it would be a far,
yeah.
it would be a much more of a grieving process.
Absolutely. I can see it.
Well, the yeah. transition would be really rough.
Yeah. I've loved being, I mean, you know, you've served in an elected office, being able to serve this community. It's amazing. And I'm grateful that I get to do it now at the State House. And, but I've loved the 14 years. Being a city councilor is just, it's awesome.
All right.
Great.
So now that you're going to now that you are a state legislature, and you'll be devoting 100% of your effort to that, tell us what's it been like for this first portion of a year, and what's on the horizon.
Oh yeah, good question. Good question, Robert.
Yeah, it's been a great year. I mean, I've spent.
Well, you know,
year...
we're very very seriously trained photo, TV journalists.
Serious journalists here, right? Serious. I put on my most serious sweater for this. And my serious earrings. You like them?
Excellent.
Oh, they're nice.
Thanks. So
read
it's been
the teleprompter there,
okay,
William.
Okay. It's been really... No, there's no teleprompter. It's... Are we going to get serious yet?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. It's been a really great year. It's been busy. You know, the first year of being a state rep, I've done two things. One, I've really spent time getting to know people, building relationships with my colleagues, with advocates, with staff at the State House. One of the things that I knew was going to be challenging is I came into the building knowing a lot of people, knowing a lot of elected officials, knowing a lot of staff, which absolutely was helpful in the foundation, but I did not want anyone to assume that, therefore I didn't need any help. So people would say, oh, you know how this place runs.
Right.
And I would say, I know where the elevators are and I can figure out where the bathrooms are. But beyond that, I wanted to make sure people really gave me as much advice as I could get
yeah.
from them. Susanna was wonderful. She was there able to help me and help my aide. No, really, it's, you know, being in office there, it just I wanted to just be a sponge and absorb as much
yeah.
as I could of sort of what's the culture today, what are the issues, and experience the relationships
that.
As a state representative. So I've been doing that all year, but it was also a really busy legislative year. Things have come up. Some of you have followed the issue of the ethanol trains.
Yep.
We're really concerned that, you know, potentially 60,000 gallons of ethanol twice a week would be coming through Cambridge and other cities across the Commonwealth. And people would say, well, what's the problem? There's toxic substance and liquids coming through all the time. For this, it was the quantity and the fact that this is a really hard thing to fight. It's a really hard fire to put out. And the amount of foam that one needs to put out this kind of a fire, an ethanol fire, the volumes are huge. So even the storage, the cost, and the expiration date. I believe like every 2 years, the foam needs to be renewed. So that, we actually did great work. I got to work with a lot of Cambridge residents, people in my district, and that was just wonderful.
It was a huge topic earlier this year.
It's still, we're not done.
Well, that's the important point, because it's, in a way, it's been stalled, but
we actually would have been done, but the governor chose to veto it and say, well, let's give us a 2-year hiatus. But we already had that hiatus. What people don't know is the courts actually came down and actually blocked the company, which is based in Waltham. And our hope is that starting in January, we're going to actually work on another mechanism to buy ourselves more time.
Right.
And that there's also hope that things will change in Congress and their relationship to ethanol will change, but we're not done. So that was a lot of time, and I got to work with a lot of other colleagues whose cities also were affected by this, and we were really successful. The House leadership and the Senate leadership and other legislators, Senator DiDomenico took a great role in this, so that was fun.
And let me just say, I know that a lot of people really appreciate the work you all did on that. It made a huge difference, and it made people feel good about government, so thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Yeah,
really a big deal.
Thank you. No, it was, you know, I also live across the street from the trains, but that aside, I would still be working really hard.
Not in my backyard.
not in anyone's backyard.
Exactly, yeah.
So that was important. Then I also have spent this whole year working on the issue of early childhood education and care, something that was really important to me as a city councilor, and I was able to jump right in, and as a freshman, I was able to actually deliver an amendment to the budget, which increased universal pre-kindergarten. It had been cut. I was able to put an amendment in that actually brought it up by almost $3 million, which was unheard of. I mean, to have that kind of an amendment as a freshman or as any legislator.
Freshmen don't do things like that. That's
and
a big move.
A really great colleague of mine, Representative Sarah Peake from the Cape, she said, you should do your maiden speech on this. And I was like, I'm not ready. She's like, it doesn't get better than this. And I was like, you're right. Usually do your maiden speech on something that really matters to you, that's important, and that you can show some achievement on. So at quarter of 11.
Tell people what a maiden speech is.
Maiden speech is the first time you speak to your colleagues in the State House.
Is that even for young men who join the legislature? They get to do maiden speeches?
They do maiden speeches. And you would be amazed at how many people have gone 2 and 3 and 4 years without giving a maiden speech.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So once you give your maiden speech, then you have, then it's more common for you to then stand up and talk about a number of issues. But the first speech you give, you really want it to be symbolic of the issue that you are, that you cared passionately about. What's the public policy issue that you want to be identified with?
Yeah, this makes me wonder, that making a transition from being a city councilor to a state representative, in many respects, the jobs are very different. You're taking on different things, but some things are similar. And I know in terms of things like either domestic violence or early child education, these are sort of right in your wheelhouse. You're like going from the minors to the majors.
Right.
Right? But I imagine not all issues are like that. There are others that are...
No, I mean, the ethanol issue, as a city councilor, you would have been... It would have been hard to play kind of a role.
Yeah, you can just comment and that's about it.
Right, that's right.
Yeah.
And so early childhood, the speaker appointed me to the Special Commission on Early Education and Care. So I'm able to join two of my House colleagues on the statewide commission, which has been amazing. The issue of domestic violence, as you know, the last 3 years I've been doing quite a bit of work on this. Yep. You will see, I think, in the next couple of weeks, I think a phenomenal re-envisioning of how our community has committed itself to domestic violence. We're about to just unroll that. We've been working closely with the city manager, so this will be
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, we're looking at reframing how we as a community, you know, how do you answer the question, where does one go when they're not safe in their home? What is the role of government if you're not safe in your home or your family? And those are questions that don't have easy answers. And one of the things we've realized is that people need to talk about it. People actually need to feel safe to say, you know, how are you, Robert? I'm getting a sense that maybe things may not be okay. Are you okay? And they're afraid. People are afraid to ask that. They're afraid. If you're afraid to ask your neighbor. And then if you do ask that, what if somebody says, no, I'm not?
Right.
Right.
Where do you go?
Well, even more complicated. Now, speaking from my experience, my brother is a New York City police officer. That's probably the single most common case you get called in is for some sort of domestic difficulty. And I sympathize with the poor police officer who comes into a home. There's a situation. He kind of knows the situation. And then the person's right there saying, oh, no, no, it's like, I'm okay, when you know very well it's not okay. So there's a lot of difficulties of how you manage these waters.
That's right. And so in Cambridge, we've done a really good job at organizing around what's called a high-risk team. There are certain factors that police and community, various community partners, are able to identify risk factors that tell you whether or not you are near homicide in the wings.
Yeah.
That we are going to try to create a more permanent way to support that work. You have a coordinator that has to organize 25 agencies, including law enforcement, social services, child development specialist. And then we're also going to be rolling out a position that will really manage what I'm calling the Domestic Violence Leadership Council, which will have over 20 stakeholders in our community. So any work that's being done around domestic violence in our community will not be done in a silo, that there will be a real coordinated effort through our schools, through our community agency partners, through all the various city departments. And the idea is that it's going to really, it's neighbor by neighbor and neighborhood by neighborhood. And if we actually start talking about the issue, so transferring that to my state work, I was able to have the Speaker of the House come to Cambridge and visit Transition House. So he was supposed to
tell people what Transition House is
in Cambridge. It is one of the first safe shelters for children, women, and mostly women. They do take men, but women and children who have been victims of domestic violence. And this is located in Cambridge. There's only 266 beds in the whole state for women and children who are fleeing their batterers. And you can imagine that's clearly not enough. If somebody has to leave their situation or their home to be safe. The speaker came to do a tour of the actual shelter and meet with six women, one who has transitioned out of that and is way beyond that in her life, but still does work in the field, and five other who were living there. Very different stories. He stayed for almost 3 hours. And that was really important as the state was looking, as the House was looking at legislation on welfare reform. This absolutely informed and I think also enabled us to, I think I was able to lead an amendment on taking out some provisions in the welfare bill that I don't think left children and women stronger. I think his visit to Cambridge and that 3-hour visit had an impact in helping me be successful in leading that amendment. And as we look at how as a state to really re-envision our work around domestic violence. There's a lot of work that I've been able to do here as a city councilor, and I think that has absolutely made me a more knowledgeable state legislator, understanding that I have proudly accepted the status of freshman. it's great to just say to people, teach me, share with me, what's the answer, or what you know I want to know.
If I'm not mistaken, it was just a few years ago, wasn't there, normally there's not a lot of turnover in the state rep seats or state senate seats, but wasn't there a period where, not so long ago, where quite a few people were leaving, taking other jobs, so that there was a lot more relatively new legislators?
Well, there's a lot of turnover in the Senate, at least.
The Senate, yeah. Is that the one?
Yeah. Now.
I think that, I didn't follow that kind of level of turnover so closely. So busy being a good city councilor, trying to be.
This year's freshman class was large.
Our class continues to grow, actually.
Yeah.
2 years ago, the freshman class was very, I think 40 people.
Yeah.
So there has been turnover.
Yeah.
People either decide they want to be somewhere else, or voters decide that.
Right.
And if you've been there a long time, sometimes it's time to go. You get tired of it.
Or sometimes you want to go, earn a big paycheck because you got three kids going to college or something, too. I'm sure, even legislatures, they have the same kind of economic pressures that a lot of other people do, too. So they have to make some decisions.
Yeah, this is not Congress.
That's not
a house of millionaires.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So.
What else is on your cheat sheet? What else you want to ask me about?
No, just stay with the teleprompter.
Well, basically, we did want to honor your last few weeks in the council. If there's anything you wanted to talk about that, or maybe you don't because you're still in the council. And we're really interested in what's happening in the State House because we don't hear that much about it. So really, it was what you were interested in and what you wanted to talk about that's what interests us.
You know, I'll just say that, again, I think because I'm able to serve, I think I'm going to feel a little bit more of the nostalgia after my last council meeting. It doesn't feel like it's completely real to me yet.
Well, it's not over.
It's not over.
You still have meetings, right?
Still have meetings, that's still have work to do. The most important thing that I have been focusing on this year and that I will, that I'm really going to be grateful once we reveal this at the next, I think maybe two more council meetings, is what I think is this transformation around how we see domestic violence as a community. Mm-hmm. I think it really is going to put Cambridge on the map nationally for a new model. And I just have to say that the last city manager and this city manager have been extraordinarily committed, not just as sort of symbolically saying, okay, Marjorie, go ahead, do that, you know, but who've actually been really in it and really working hard to understand what are all the moving pieces that we need to bring together. And I've been doing this for 3 years and it's been intense. And I think people don't realize city councils, I think they think of us as sort of going from issue to issue. It's sort of, you know, slide to slide. Right. But this has been a 3-year process and it's taken that much work and relationship building and trial and error to see sort of how can we re-envision ourselves as a community to understanding the issue of domestic violence and believing that business as usual, sort of people think that if there's a domestic violence incident that, and it's, you know, often public safety officials will say, oh, everyone's safe, you know, go back home, you're mm-hmm. fine. Oh, time's up.
No.
Just so we've got 30 seconds.
That's all. Okay. And it's not business as usual. You know, none of us actually should feel safe knowing that we have neighbors or sisters or brothers or coworkers who are at risk. And the level of people the level of calls of domestic violence in Cambridge have escalated over the years.
Mm. Well, when it solidifies, would you come back and talk to us about it?
I will.
As time goes on, we would love to hear more about this.
I will.
It's an important issue.
It's great to be here with you guys.
But for now.
We love having you here. This is Cambridge Inside Out.
And we'll see you in a few minutes.